I always get asked, why is it that I've called my channel DBZ Imran, but I only make Bleach analysis videos? I did make a lot of Dragon Ball content earlier on when I first started the channel, but it wasn't getting any views. And also, I feel like Dragon Ball has been talked about to death on YouTube. But because it is one of my favourite manga series, I wanted to try to analyse one of the characters which I feel like can be analysed from Dragon Ball. I'm not an authority on Dragon Ball, but I am very opinionated about it. I feel like Dragon Ball is a very simplistic story, and its characters are also very simple. There isn't much to really analyze or understand, as everything is really self-explanatory. Goku is laid back, carefree, and desires to fight strong opponents. Vegeta is prideful and arrogant and desires to claim his birthright by surpassing Goku. Piccolo is stoic and becomes a lot more understanding after he fuses with Nail and Kami. What makes Dragon Ball a really light-hearted read-through is that Goku and company will always be there to face off against any opponent who comes to challenge them, no matter how strong that they are. However, these feelings of reassurance quickly fade when we begin to analyze Future Trunks, who comes from a alternative reality where Goku and company were not able to overcome the threat that was presented to them. Imagine the joyful and cheerful world of Dragon Ball being replaced with a hopeless reality. A world where Goku has died, and the Z Fighters were all defeated by two artificial humans who were created by a scientist who holds a grudge against Goku for defeating the Red Ribbon Army as a child. This is the environment where the character that I'm analyzing this week was nurtured in. Without further delay, let's analyze this version of Trunks who comes from a hopeless future. Let's understand his backstory and his relationships that he forms with the characters when he arrives in the present timeline. How do these interactions impact Trunks as a character? And most importantly, what growth does this character go through to liberate his timeline from the threat of the androids and even Cell? Future Trunks makes his debut appearance in episode 119 of the anime, and in chapter 330 of the Dragon Ball manga. For most people, growing up, Trunks was probably their first experience with encountering a really cool character. Someone who oozes with an air of mystery that you're dying to learn more about. The mystery behind his character doesn't take too long to unravel, as we learn that he is the blue-eyed, purple-haired son of Bulma and Vegeta. But prior to learning any of this, his initial introduction left us all confused. Who is this character who dons the very familiar Capsule Cop insignia on his blue jacket? Through his introduction, we learn that there is another survivor to the almost extinct Saiyan race. Vegeta points this out clearly, as he says that himself, Gohan, and Goku are the only remaining survivors of the Saiyan race. I remember wondering, how was this sword-wielding character able to transform into a Super Saiyan and go face-to-face with Frieza like it's nothing? Remembering back to when I first experienced Dragon Ball, I remember Future Trunks distinctively, as he kickstarts my favourite story which is told throughout the series. It is no secret that I absolutely love the Android Saga and the Cell Saga. I love how it begins with Trunks arriving to challenge Frieza, and how it ends with Trunks defeating the androids and Cell in his timeline, finally restoring peace to his world. Before we explore the deeper nuances of Trunks' character, let's go through his backstory and understand what leads to him finally transforming into a Super Saiyan and taking the risk to travel back in time to help Goku and the others. Like I mentioned before, this version of Trunks grows up in a reality which was destroyed and terrorized by Android 17 and 18. The two androids have succeeded in drastically reducing the population of the world and spreading their destruction throughout the planet. This reality has an air of hopelessness, as even Goku has died. He passes away 6 months prior to the arrival of the androids due to a heart virus. He leaves behind his closest allies, who are all killed by the androids, with the exception of his son Gohan. The androids within Trunks' timeline were designed to have power which surpasses even Goku's. Because of this, the rest of the Z Fighters were really no match for them. The reason why these stakes feel so high in Trunks' timeline is that the Dragon Balls cannot be used to wish back anyone that was killed by the androids, as when Piccolo died, Kami died alongside with him. This transforms the Dragon Balls into useless stones, which no longer serve their purpose of granting wishes. Trunks and Gohan are the only survivors in this bleak reality. They are the only hopes for humanity to be freed from the androids. Growing up, Trunks was mentored by Gohan. We learn about all of these events through the second Dragon Ball Z TV special. Through this TV special, we learn that a vital part of Trunks' training was for him to transform into a Super Saiyan. Without attaining this form, it would be pointless for him to go up against the androids. You would think that it would be easy for Trunks to transform into a Super Saiyan, as his entire life has been riddled with death and misery, considering that his own father was killed by the androids, and not to mention all of the endless suffering that they inflict onto the world. Despite how traumatic these experiences may be, this was how Trunks was brought up. He didn't know any other world, he wasn't brought up in peace. His father had died before he even had a chance to know him, so thinking about his loss probably would not be able to ignite within him that level of sadness and sorrow which would awaken his Super Saiyan form. I love the history of Trunks TV special, as it does a really good job of showing how hopeless Gohan and Trunks' situation really is. There is a scene where Gohan and Trunks go up against the androids in an amusement park, and Trunks is utterly outmatched. In order to save his life, Gohan sacrifices his own arm to protect him. This entire story has an air of hopelessness, as Trunks is continually disheartened. He loses his confidence, especially after he encounters the androids and realizes how powerful they are firsthand. I keep mentioning this idea of hopelessness as I feel like it's a theme that relates strongly to Trunks' character, especially during his developmental years, and it helps explain his later appearances in the series. Soon after, a key moment occurs which serves as the trigger for Trunks' Super Saiyan transformation. As we know, Gohan is eventually killed by the androids. When Trunks finds his body in the pouring rain, he grieves, as his emotions overwhelm him and he transforms into the legendary Super Saiyan. We know that the bond between a student and a mentor is incredibly strong, but what makes his relationship with Gohan even stronger is that Trunks didn't have a father growing up, so the only person aside from his own mother that he felt like he had in his life was Gohan. Little by little, the androids snatch away everything of value in Trunks' life. This is the first time that Trunks truly experiences sorrow and grief. His bond with Gohan served as an anchor for his character. No matter how hopeless the situation may have seemed, he always had Gohan to go back to. But after his loss, he has truly become the lone warrior of the future. There is literally no one else that humanity can rely upon. Trunks is the last hope for the future. Remember earlier on when I said that Dragon Ball is a really lighthearted story? Future Trunks and his entire story is the rare occasion within Dragon Ball where the story got really dark and serious. And it was a welcome surprise to experience an alternative reality where for once the villains had succeeded, and the warriors that we grew up to love and cherish were not invincible after all. During the few years that Bulma takes to complete a time machine, Trunks continues to train without Gohan. Despite him growing stronger, he is still no match for the androids. After an encounter with the androids which leaves him hospitalized, Bulma reveals to him the time machine, in the hopes that he will use it to return to the past and save Goku. She believes that it would be an invaluable experience for Trunks to train with Goku and the others, and to warn them about the threat of the androids before they arrive. All of this information about Trunks' backstory is given to us via supplementary material, which is supposed to be consumed in addition to the Dragon Ball manga. So now that we know about the origin of his character, let's look at his introduction into the present timeline of Dragon Ball. In addition to this, I will also go over Trunks' relationship with his father and how this affects him as a character. As understandably, he has never met his father, so he must have formed expectations prior to meeting him. In addition to this, it's interesting to see how Trunks interacts with the cast of the Dragon Ball characters, as it is apparent that his mother must have been telling him about all of them and their individual traits while he was growing up. I want to start by studying Trunks' opinion of Goku and why I believe this is a great starting point to analysing his appearances within the manga. Trunks is properly introduced to us in chapter 331, as his first words are a declaration that he has come to kill Frieza. When Frieza decides to entertain Trunks as an opponent, Trunks offers him some advice and suggests that he doesn't hold back against him, as he is no pushover like Goku. I love the way that Toriyama writes the introduction of Trunks' character. He rarely lives up to his title as the mysterious youth. There are so many questions that you are left with after reading the chapter that he is introduced within, as Trunks reveals that he has never met Goku, but he knows a lot about him. And he also reveals that Goku isn't the only one who can transform into a Super Saiyan. Trunks lives up to every claim that he states. He does indeed transform into a Super Saiyan in the very chapter that he is introduced within. After he effortlessly defeats Frieza and his father, the mystery behind his character is revealed to us when he speaks with Goku after he arrives from the planet Yardrat. Goku was indeed supposed to have defeated Frieza and his father, but due to a time discrepancy, Trunks was forced to intervene. This is the first in a number of time discrepancies that occur when Trunks travels from his timeline to the past. As we know, this conversation that Trunks has with Goku serves to fill him in on the threats of the androids, as well as revealing the origins of Trunks. We learn that he has come from 20 years in the future, and indeed he has Saiyan blood which he inherits from his father Vegeta. But of course, the real reason that he has come from the future is to warn Goku and the others about a threat that will emerge 3 years from now. He tells them that on the morning of May 12th, a fearsome duo will emerge, and they will possess power beyond their imagination. Of course, the threat that he is warning Goku about are the artificial humans created by Dr. Gero. He also tells him that he dies before he can even engage in combat with the androids. Goku feels frustration, as he feels like he was robbed before he could even fight the androids by this heart virus. Trunks is surprised by Goku being upset that he cannot fight with them. He wonders why he isn't afraid. Goku does admit that he is afraid, but he reassuringly says that he would have liked to have at least had a chance to know if he could beat them. This response appears to validate Trunks' efforts, as he is given hope by Goku's words. He ensures that Goku will survive and have a chance to fight against the androids by handing him over the cure to the heart virus. This momentary action has dire consequences, as it's going to change history, but Trunks feels that this change in history is necessary, as Goku's survival will make a difference. The faith that he has in Goku can be credited to Bulma, as she worked tirelessly on the time machine for the sole purpose of saving Goku's life. Before leaving for his timeline, Trunks affirms that Goku lives up to the image that Bulma instilled within him of his character. After seeing his strength firsthand, he feels that there is hope for the future. Before he leaves in his time machine, he describes his father as strong, proud, and stern. However, he is lonely, just like his mother had described. This is the beginning of the relationship that he starts to form with his father, and it continues to grow and develop when he returns after the androids arrive. Growing up with very few people to call his family and his friends, Trunks spends some time with the Z Fighters and the warriors who passed away in his timeline. He feels an attachment to all of these characters who no longer exist within his timeline. It is understandable to assume that Trunks must feel a sense of belonging with all of them, especially while they are waiting for Goku to arrive, as he sees everybody's personalities and their quirks and how they immediately feel like family to him. While growing up, his mother must have told him countless stories about all of these people that he is just meeting. It must be a crushing reminder to realize that if it wasn't for the androids, then he would be anything but lonely. He would be surrounded by this powerful, goofy cast of characters, which we have all fallen in love with through experiencing the Dragon Ball story. I fell in love with Dragon Ball at a very early age, before I even started to watch movies, but when I did, I saw a striking resemblance to the Android Saga and the Terminator movies. For example, Trunks warns Goku that two androids will arrive on May 12th. May 12th is the exact date that the Terminator arrived in the past in the first Terminator movie, and of course it is pretty obvious that Toriyama was inspired by the future that is described within the Terminator universe, a future which is controlled by cyborgs who run on artificial intelligence. Another interesting fact is that chapter 330 was published in summer 1991. This coincides with the summer 1991 release of Terminator 2. I'm not sure if this comparison has been made before, but Trunks' hair always reminded me of John Connor's hair in the second Terminator movie. It's my personal opinion, but I believe that Terminator 2 is one of the best movies ever made. Through making this video, learning that the second Terminator movie may have inspired the Android Saga, it makes me love it even more. We see Trunks again in chapter 346, when he returns from the future. He looks over at the location where the androids were supposed to have arrived, but he sees no sign of Goku or the others. The island has been completely destroyed, and he is concerned because he doesn't have enough energy in his time machine to go further back in time. However, he senses that energy off in the distance, and is reassured that they are still fighting, but elsewhere. While he is flying to the location of the others, he discovers the head of Android 19, and he is puzzled, because this android isn't the same one that's been terrorizing his future. He is confused as to who these androids are that have appeared. If you've done any digging into the mindset of Toriyama during the Android Saga, then you'll know that Android 19 and 20 were originally supposed to be the androids that were terrorizing Trunks' timeline, and they were meant to be the main antagonists of this arc. However, his first editor was disappointed by the appearances of Android 19 and 20, describing them as some old guy and a fat guy, so during the arc he just spontaneously decides to switch these androids up for Android 17 and 18. You can see the inconsistencies happen while Trunks is speaking to Goku. He explicitly warns him that Android called 19 and 20 will arrive, and indeed they did arrive, but they ended up being totally different, and it was actually Android 17 and 18 that he was warning him about. This isn't as obvious in the anime, but in the manga you can really tell that Toriyama was just making this up as he was going along. It's a little bit of a tangent, but it's Trunks' character who is forced to actually deal with Toriyama's inconsistencies and try and wrap his head around them. All of this is explained off by using Trunks as a scapegoat, as him traveling back in time altered the events that took place. When Trunks finally catches up with everyone and encounters Dr. Gero with the others, Vegeta comes to realize that this Trunks is indeed his son from the future, and so begins his very dysfunctional relationship with future Trunks. It is put to the test immediately when Bulma arrives to get a glimpse of Dr. Gero to see if she recognizes him. She irresponsibly brings baby Trunks with her, and of course Dr. Gero attacks the ship that she is in. Vegeta appears to show no concern that Bulma and his newborn son were just attacked. Instead, he is more concerned with battling the androids. In one of their first encounters since he first arrived, saved. Trunks questions why he didn't try to save them, and Vegeta's response absolutely shatters Trunks' image of his father. As he describes Bulma and his newborn son as holding no meaning to him, he doesn't care about them. This leaves Trunks utterly speechless and understandably in shock. After Vegeta transforms into a Super Saiyan, he becomes even more arrogant than before. He underestimates the threat of the androids, while Trunks continues to emphasize how powerful they are. Everybody is in agreement that they would prefer to destroy 17 and 18 before Dr. Gero activates them, and this is indeed what Trunks would have desired also. But Vegeta has convinced himself that he is strong enough to face off against them. Even if they don't make it in time to stop Dr. Gero from activating the androids, Trunks' faith in Goku urges him to insist that everybody should wait until Goku is better again before they fight against the androids. It makes sense, as without Goku, all of them ended up dying in his timeline. So the one thing that Trunks did indeed change was Goku's survival. So waiting for him to recover from the heart virus and then challenging the androids seems like a really good idea in my opinion. Trunks is all too aware that a Super Saiyan is nowhere near as powerful enough to face off against these androids. Even after knowing his father for a brief time, he has already concluded that his father is a fool, but he is adamant that he isn't going to let him die against the androids in this timeline also. This sentiment, coupled with his desire to form a relationship with a father that he never had, results in Trunks consistently pursuing Vegeta throughout this arc. At the end of chapter 348, while Trunks is flying and trying to catch up with Vegeta, he remembers some words from his mother from his timeline. She describes Vegeta as having done a lot of bad things, even going as far as to describe where he would be in the afterlife, saying that he is surely in hell. However, she admits that there are some good things about him, but it was his pride that was holding him back and preventing him from showing kindness to others. But she tells Trunks that she could tell that he did have kindness within him. Even after remembering these words from his mother, he doubts if there is any shred of good within Vegeta at all, using the example of him not saving Bulma and his newborn baby as proof that he is evil. But when you think about it, Trunks arrived on the battleground, and Piccolo referred to him by his name, and this of course leads Vegeta to make the logical assumption that this is his son from the future. He probably wasn't concerned with Bulma and his son because he knew that future Trunks would probably go to save them. If he wasn't there, I'm pretty sure that he would have gone to protect them. And I'm pretty sure that this is the logical thinking that Trunks is going through in order to reassure himself that his father isn't entirely evil. After the androids are activated, Vegeta tries to battle with them, but Trunks is persistent that he shouldn't until Goku gets better. He believes that none of them stand a chance unless they fight together with Goku. And like I said before, Trunks doesn't believe that Vegeta can face off against them on his own. He firmly believes that he'll be going to his death if he goes to battle them alone. Trunks is punched and told to get out of the way as Vegeta flies off to battle the androids. You have to commend Trunks for the persistence that he shows and his patience that he has for his arrogant father. Despite how unpleasant and rude Vegeta is, he doesn't want this timeline's version of himself to grow up without a father. And for this very reason, he'll do anything to prevent Vegeta's death. While he is getting absolutely beaten by Android 18, Trunks looks on in complete shock. His emotions overwhelm him as he feels like he is about to witness his father's death. This triggers him to transform into a Super Saiyan and to intervene in their battle. The androids soundly beat everyone and appear not to be as lethal as the androids from Trunks' timeline. They don't end up killing anyone and even reassure Krillin that they are still alive and that he should feed them a Senzu Bean. Before leaving, they don't even ask for the whereabouts of Goku as they feel like it would be more fun to search for him themselves, and they appear to be excited by the possibility that he would probably come after them. These androids that were activated in this timeline don't appear to be as ruthless and lethal as the androids from Trunks' timeline, but their more relaxed attitude doesn't change Trunks' opinion of them. He still believes them to be ruthless killers. When Trunks and Krillin arrive at Goku's home in order to relocate him, they have a conversation on the plane that they use to travel to Kame House. Trunks explains how time traveling works and how even if he saves Goku in this timeline, it wouldn't change the events of his timeline. Him going back and changing the past, all it does is create another reality with an alternative future. So there would be a future where Goku has survived and a future where Goku has died. Yamcha questions Trunks and asks him then why has he come back to the past if his future isn't going to change. His response helps to shed a lot of light about his current situation and his mindset during this time. The Bulma from the past was driven by the horrible things that the androids did. She believed that a timeline where the androids were destroyed deserved to exist. So for this purpose, she developed the time machine. She also believed that if Trunks was able to save Goku, then together they may have been able to come up with a weakness for the androids. As a last resort, she even considered to bring Goku to her timeline using the time machine in order to kill the androids. But what is puzzling Trunks is that the past that he has returned to differs from the past that he knows. The timing of Goku's illness was different, and there are three androids instead of two, and they are far stronger than the androids from his timeline. Soon after this, we learn that Bulma discovers an abandoned time machine, the exact one that Trunks had used to travel back to the past. We eventually learn that this is of course the time machine that Cell used to travel back in time. Thanks to Trunks' time traveling, there's a reality now where he had returned to the future and had killed the androids, but he wasn't aware of Cell and his existence. So after he was activated, there were no androids for him to absorb, so he ambushes Trunks and steals his time machine. I always feel sorry for this version of Trunks that was killed by Cell, and I wonder what happened to future Bulma in that timeline, wondering if she feels responsible for the death of her son, as he was killed so that Cell could return to a time where the android still existed. In chapter 358, when Trunks arrives to examine this abandoned time machine, we learn that he wrote the word hope onto the time machine on the day that he left, and this is in line with the theme of hopelessness which I was talking about before, as the time machine was their final hope. After having seen Cell for himself, Vegeta decides that he is going to ascend beyond a Super Saiyan. This leads to Trunks deciding that he's going to train with him. He is interested to see if there is really such a way to transcend beyond the Super Saiyan state. In chapter 366, Goku arrives at Trunks and Vegeta's location. He proposes to take Vegeta and Trunks to the Room of Spirit and Time, where they can train for a whole year in the space of one day. It's a very promising offer, since all Trunks has done is stare at his father, as he's been standing on the edge of a cliff for 3 days, unwilling to train with him. Before the two of them enter the Room of Spirit and Time, Goku wishes them good luck and requests for Vegeta to try and get along with him. It is funny to think about how Trunks survived in this space with Vegeta for a whole year. In the Room of Spirit and Time, the temperature can change from extremely hot to extremely cold. The air is very thin, and the gravity is greater than the gravity on Earth. This entire space is just an empty void. It's an area with nothing but white space as far as the eye can see. Trunks also wonders how is he going to survive a whole year with his father in a place like this. Trunks and Vegeta emerge from the Room of Spirit and Time in chapter 375. Trunks explains how Vegeta broke through the barrier of a Super Saiyan within the first 2 months of their training, but he wasn't satisfied with his power, so he continued to train. Once again, after his training, Vegeta is very arrogant and immediately thinks that he can defeat Cell and the androids with his current state of power. Trunks follows Vegeta as we see them both encounter Cell, and we learn how, even after spending a year together, their relationship is still far from perfect. The problem is, Vegeta's desire to battle an incredibly powerful opponent causes him to become interested to see how powerful Cell would become if he was to attain perfection. According to Dr. Gero, Cell's power, speed, skill, and mental strength would all become perfect in every way after he absorbs Android 18. When Vegeta stops fighting Cell and gives him permission to absorb Android 18, Trunks intervenes. He knows all too well how powerful Dr. Gero's creations are, and he knows not to underestimate them like Vegeta has been doing throughout this whole arc. Trunks is unwilling to just stand by and watch as Cell completes himself. Vegeta, on the other hand, stoops to new lows as he attacks his own son before he can stop Cell from absorbing Android 18. Trunks insists to his father that he shouldn't let Cell become complete. He warns him, what if Cell becomes stronger than both of them? But Vegeta's stubborn arrogance makes him think that this is the way that a coward would think. He speaks to the same blood which runs through Trunks and asks him, doesn't he want to see how strong Cell can truly become? But Trunks is not interested in any of this at all. He has seen the future and the hell that Dr. Gero's creations have unleashed upon the Earth. This is a turning point for Trunks' character, as he is even willing to kill his own father to stop Cell. But Vegeta calls his bluff and says that he doesn't have the guts to attack his own father. But it appears that Trunks has finally lost his patience with Vegeta, and he does indeed attack him. But his efforts are in vain, as Cell does indeed absorb Android 18. And achieves his perfect form. While Vegeta is fighting Perfect Cell, Trunks speaks with Krillin, who says that he knows the true depths of Cell's power after having just been hit by him. He also says that Vegeta doesn't seem to be aware that Trunks has already surpassed him. He tells Trunks that he knows that he isn't admitting this to hurt Vegeta's pride, but he did indeed break through the wall that Vegeta could not during their training in the Room of Spirit and Time. Trunks even admits this and says that his dad did indeed surpass the limits of a Super Saiyan, and he did indeed attain incredible power, but during their training, Trunks was able to surpass his father, as he came to realize what Goku was talking about when he spoke of ascending beyond a Super Saiyan. Trunks admits that he could never tell his father this because he is just too proud, and he says that it was his father's mistake to allow Cell to become perfect, and he should have beaten Cell with his pride intact while he had the chance. Trunks can do nothing but watch on as Cell defeats his father. Krillin wonders why Trunks isn't going to help him, but Trunks, having spent enough time with his father now, knows that he would find it humiliating if he was rescued by his own son. He would rather prefer to lose to Cell, because that's just the way that he is. It is causing Trunks incredible frustration to watch his father get beaten by Cell. There is every possibility that Vegeta may die if Trunks doesn't intervene, but to respect his father's pride, he is only going to intervene when he is unconscious, because that way, Vegeta wouldn't be able to see Trunks prove that he has become stronger than him. After Vegeta becomes unconscious, Trunks does indeed transform into this new Super Saiyan state. fight. He even tells Krillin not to worry about him, as he is going to prevail. Krillin is surprised by his boastful claim, as he knows that Trunks isn't the type to be overly confident. This battle between Trunks and Cell is a very humbling experience for Trunks. While he approaches Cell, he says that his time is up and he's going to kill him. The Saiyan blood that runs within Cell causes him to be really interested in Trunks' true power. He appears to be excited to test out the true extent of his power in his complete form, and Trunks promises not to disappoint him. While admittedly, Trunks has transformed into a more powerful state, he is slower than before. Trunks naively doesn't pick up on this, and Cell takes this as an opportunity to teach him a lesson. As we know, he is unable to keep up with Cell's speed in his new bulky form. Frustratingly, Trunks finds it hard to comprehend why he cannot keep up with Cell. Cell goes on to humiliate Trunks by saying that his new transformation isn't anything magnificent, as he replicates the form in his own body and says that this transformation may be incredibly powerful, but this form causes a huge drop in speed to compensate for that increased power. Trunks admits that his efforts were conceited, and he was indeed being a fool, especially to assume that he was stronger than his father. Vegeta didn't transform into this form because he knew that this would have happened. He was well aware of the limitations of this form, and for this reason decided that it was pointless to use it against Cell. After coming to this harsh realization, Trunks does give up. He returns to his normal form and says that he just doesn't stand a chance against Cell. He is utterly defeated in this moment and frustratingly tells Cell to just kill him. When Cell asks Trunks about the whereabouts of Goku, Trunks tells him that they will meet soon enough because he is training and he'll be the one to do what Trunks could not. During the Cell games in chapter 413, when Cell returns after self-destructing, his reappearance shocks everyone and his first act is to impale future Trunks through his chest. Proving that a bond did form between Vegeta and future Trunks, Vegeta reacts uncontrollably when he sees that his son has been killed by Cell. It's a shame that future Trunks wasn't alive to see his father get emotional and show affection towards him. If you recall back to Trunks thinking about how his mother described his father and how she said that he did have kindness within him, his reaction to Trunks being killed in this moment proves that there is some good within him. After Cell is defeated by Gohan, Trunks' body is taken to Kami's lookout. They summon Shenron and they wish for everyone who was killed by Cell to be brought back to life. As a result of this wish, future Trunks is revived and brought back to life. He ends up learning about how Vegeta reacted to his death while he is flying with Yamcha. He tells him how Vegeta got really angry after Trunks was killed, and he attacked Cell without even thinking about his own safety. I'm glad that Toriyama had wrote this scene into the story, as I feel like it was really important for Trunks to know that his father deep down did indeed care for him. When Trunks leaves to return to his timeline to face off against the androids, he says goodbye to everyone and even gets an acknowledgement from his father, which is more than enough for him. In chapter 419, we get the end to future Trunks' story, as he returns back to his timeline and fills his mother in on everything that had happened, and how thanks to her time machine and Trunks' intervention, a future now exists where everybody survives, of course aside from Goku, who ended up dying anyway. Trunks even admits to his mother that she was right, his father wasn't heartless after all, explaining to Bulma about how he got really angry after learning that Trunks had been killed. Despite all of this, they may have secured peace in one timeline, but there is still peace to restore in his current timeline. Trunks finally heads out to put a stop to the androids who have been terrorizing his world. He avenges the deaths of everybody close to him, and especially Gohan, by killing Android 17 and 18. 3 years after this, Trunks encounters Imperfect Cell, who is trying to go back in time. Trunks ends up killing the last of Dr. Gero's creations and finally brings peace to the future. In the final panel that future Trunks appears in the manga, Toriyama writes that Trunks and Bulma had lived a hard life, but true peace had come at last, a peace that would be enjoyed as long as Trunks was there to defend it. Having gone through all of his appearances within the manga, it was incredibly fun to reveal information about the mysterious youth, who we knew so little about during his introduction. I find it so interesting how Trunks comes to the past with so many expectations and ideas of how things would have unfolded, but everything ends up being really unpredictable and beyond anything that he could have imagined. There were some elements that matched up with his expectations, in particular his expectations of Goku and his character, and how throughout this entire arc, Trunks had always had faith in Goku's abilities, and even up until the end, he believed that Goku had a trick up his sleeve, but he wasn't aware that Goku's secret weapon this whole time was Gohan. I've always loved how Trunks encounters a younger version of his mentor, and how Gohan in the end does indeed live up to the future version of himself. If you want to learn more about Trunks as a character, I made a video when I first started this channel called The Future Trunks Side Story. The screenwriter for the Dragon Ball Z anime had created three side stories which explored the thoughts of the character characters during various moments within the manga. Future Trunks was one of the characters that was covered, and the video that I created covers Trunks' thoughts through some pivotal moments during the manga. The whole video serves to shed more light on his relationship with his father, and what he thought about his father even before he went to the past. If you love this video and want more of an insightful look into Future Trunks' character, then I definitely recommend that video. What do you think of Future Trunks? Did you like my first Dragon Ball Z character analysis? If you want more content like this in the future, then leave a comment and let me know. And for next week, I'm going to be covering a fan favorite. Yes, I'm analyzing Byakuya Kuchiki from Bleach. So stick around by subscribing and turning on the bell notifications so that you're the first person to watch my Byakuya Kuchiki analysis video when it drops next week. If you enjoyed this video and would like to see more like it, then please consider supporting my channel on Patreon. I have multiple tiers with rewards including access to an exclusive Discord server, video scripts, as well as being the first to know about unreleased upcoming videos. Thank you for your time, and whatever you choose to contribute, I will appreciate and it will mean a lot to me.